In which war did you serve?
Vietnam.
What was your branch of service?
The United States Air Force.
What was your highest rank?
Captain.
In what general locations did you serve?
I started out at Pope Air Force Base in North Carolina. From there I went to Southeast Asia, where we flew out of Thailand, Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base. Came home from there and was assigned to Langley Air Force Base in Virginia.
Were you drafted or did you enlist?
I enlisted. I would have been drafted if I didn't. So this way I got to choose the branch of service I wanted.
Where were you living at the time?
At home in Cheshire, Connecticut.
Oh. Do you recall the date?
It was officially February of 1969.
Well, why did you join?
If I didn't enlist in the Air Force, I would have been drafted into the Army. And at the time, my feeling was I'd rather fly over it than walk through it.
Why did you pick the service branch you joined?
It seemed, had the most interest for me, for one thing. It wasn't just slogging through rice paddies. I had some responsibilities, and I was going in as an officer instead of a basic enlisted guy.
Oh, how does that?
When I took the test for the Air Force, I qualified for a pilot, except for my eyes, and they suggested, how about a navigator? And that was fine with me.
Tell me about your first days in service.
I was a 90-day wonder through Medina Air Force Base in San Antonio, Texas. Basically, it was a compressed educational facility with a stress on physical education. And after about 90 days, you are upgraded from a staff sergeant to a second lieutenant.
How did it feel?
Fine. I was doing what I wanted to do with the service that I wanted to be in.
Yeah. Tell me about your boot camp or training experiences.
That was at Medina. The first days you were assigned a room with three other cadets. You went through the routine of the haircuts and the psychological play that comes along with it. So it was quite different than I was used to. It was never so regimented before, but you get used to it very quickly or you don't last.
Do you remember your instructors?
I had several, teaching different phases of different subjects. So no, I don't.
How did you get through it?
You swallow hard and you do what you have to do.
So after boot camp, where did you go?
From there I went to Mather Air Force Base in California. I was there for 9 months for navigator training.
So what did that entail? Like, what's navigator training?
That's learning how to use a sextant, all the electronic aids, map reading at night. Mm-hmm. It's how to get the airplane from point A to point B the way they want you to go.
Okay. What were your first impressions when you arrived there?
At Mather.
Yeah.
It was a little upsetting. We were put in bachelor officer quarters. This is with my wife. And the first night we were there, we had to open some suitcases and changed and cleaned up. We were watching television, and I went into the kitchen and turned the light on, and the walls moved. They were there were a plethora of cockroaches.
Oh.
Shortly after we moved out of there, they tore the building down.
Wow.
was a little unpleasant, but we ended up with base housing, and that worked out fine for us.
So after that training, where did you go?
From May 3rd, I was assigned to Pope Air Force Base in North Carolina with the 779th Tactical Airlift Squadron.
And so what did you do there?
I was a navigator and responsible for dropping equipment. Mm-hmm. So we routinely dropped the 82nd, 101st Airborne, as well as equipment, howitzers, whatever they wanted to drop.
Okay. And then after that, where did you go?
From Pope Air Force Base, I went to Southeast Asia, to Udorn Royal Thai Air Force Base, and was flying out of there for most of my time in Southeast Asia. However, we did move from Udorn to Nakhon Phanom for about 30 days, and then we moved down to Korat Air Force Base in Thailand.
So what did you do? Was that also?
That was the airborne command and control, mm-hmm. and we would take off at 6 p.m. and land at 6 a.m. And basically, we carried intelligence people in the back of our aircraft and allowed them to perform their duties. They wanted us over specific areas, in Laos, Cambodia, and Vietnam.
And what was your first impressions for there?
It was very interesting. The first flight out, you had to fly for 15 minutes before you crossed the Mekong River. Mm-hmm. They call it the fence. As soon as you cross the fence, you could look down and you could see anti-aircraft coming up.
Oh, wow.
It started out, we were low and slow and very heavy, but they always use the wrong altitude. So that was good for me.
So please describe a typical day for you in the service.
It depended if I was flying or not. If I was flying, like I said, we took off at 6 p.m. and landed at 6 a.m. If I wasn't, I was also the assistant intelligence officer for the squadron. And that has some duties. I was a briefing officer as well as an instructor navigator.
Oh, well, what was that like?
The instructor part?
Yeah.
Everybody has to have a check flight. That's to make sure that your skills are up to snuff. So part of it was taking new people in, showing them what they had to do, where they had to go, and making sure they continue to do that on a regular basis.
And the other one was intelligence?
Yes. That entailed writing up briefings, assigning orbits for the flights for the airborne and command and control intelligence people in the back of the aircraft when you flew.
Oh. Okay. Did you see combat?
Yes. Luckily, it was never too close. Like I said, all night long we had anti-aircraft fire. You know, once we were chased by a MiG, and it's just you push the nose down and get across the Mekong River, and you're safe. But other than that, really no. They never got close enough, which was good.
Yeah. Were there any casualties in your unit?
No. It was a relatively safe job compared to some of the other ones that were out there. So I was very happy to get the assignment because I had a child born while I was there. And who knows what would have happened if that wasn't my assignment.
Were you awarded any medals or citations? Which ones and how did you get them?
Okay, well, when you enlist, you get the National Defense Service Medal. So I had that one. Flying in Southeast Asia, I got two air medals, or air medal for the first Oak Leaf Cluster. And it was for finding the shortest route across the Mekong River when we were chased. And the other was avoiding some severe weather that happened during the monsoons.
Wow.
And there was the standard three medals that you got when you served was the National Defense Service Medal, the Vietnam Service, and the Vietnam Campaign. Oh. So I had two Vietnam Campaign stars.
So how did you stay in touch with your family?
Most of the time it was letters. A couple of times I sent recorded messages. And probably the most memorable was while I was flying, our flight engineer, who was a ham radio operator, hooked us up with someone in the United States who transferred the call to my home.
Oh, wow.
The problem was his call sign was Rasputin. And when he called my home to speak to my wife, he said, "Hi, this is Rasputin. I have a call from your husband." And she said, "Yeah, right. Click." He did call her back, and we did establish communication.
Okay. What was the food like?
Food was very good. They took good care of us. I got no complaints about that. Food, medical, sleeping facilities, it was all good.
So was it American food? How did they?
You had your choice at the officer's club. You could get a steak if you wanted a steak. You could have Thai food, Vietnamese food. Really, whatever was on the menu was open for you.
Oh, wow. Did you have enough supplies?
Yes, we never ran short of anything.
Did you feel pressure or stress, and how did you handle it?
I think you always feel stressed in a situation where you're being shot at. After a while, I think you tended to become a little numb. Mm-hmm. You haven't hit me yet, you're not going to get me tonight. So. One of those, and that's how I handled it. So.
Yeah. Was there something special you did for good luck?
No, I really didn't have any superstitions about that. You climb in the plane and away you go. I think the strangest thing I did was when we first turned on the air conditioning unit, it was usually filled with mosquitoes. So I was one of the designated slappers. I think my record was 103 in the first 10 minutes.
Wow.
You count them as you go.
So how did people entertain themselves?
They had covered us pretty well. They had movie theaters. There was a bar that had the usual games, foosball and pool tables. Tennis courts, squash, and racquetball courts. So they even had a swimming pool. So there was lots to do.
Did you see any USO shows?
No, not even close.
Were there any entertainers? Did anyone come?
No, not well. There was local entertainment. They had some very good bands that said the syllables but didn't understand the words, but they were still good, interesting.
Did you go on leave? Where did you go and what did you do?
I came home on leave for my 30 days. So I ended up, I took Pan Am Flight 1, I think it was. But I came home to Cheshire, Connecticut, where my wife was, and spent my time over Christmas.
Seeing your daughter for the first time.
Yes. Yep, seeing my daughter for the first time, says my wife from afar.
Do you recall any particularly humorous or unusual events to share with you?
Nothing specific, no, other than snapping mosquitoes.
Got it. What were some of the pranks you or others would pull?
There was a tradition that they had that on your last flight, before you rotated home, when you got off your aircraft, they would hose you down with a fire hose, just soak you completely. That worked out well until the flight was delayed for a while. The fire hose sat in the sun, and the water got hot enough to burn the individual, so that was stopped.
Wow. What did you think of the officers and your fellow servicemen?
As an officer, I like the officers. But I was never really one to drive the enlisted people. And they were fine. We flew as a crew. We got to know each other. There was still military discipline, but it wasn't, you have to do it my way. It was kind of a give and take.
So you're with them for a long time in the planes, so what did you talk about?
We talked about everything from some of the F-4s used to play bounce moonbeam, so they would come up, fly under us, and then pull up right in front, so you fly through their jet wash and bounces the plane around. I forgot where I was going with that. Could you start that question again?
Sure. What did you guys talk about?
Oh, yes. It was just about everything. It was what was going on at home, who was going off base that night. It was like you would have a conversation with four or five of your friends in your dorm room.
Did you keep a journal?
No, I didn't.
Where were you when your service ended? Tell me about the day and being discharged.
My service ended at Langley Air Force Base in Virginia. That's where I separated from. It was kind of bittersweet. For a while I had thought I was going to make the Air Force a career, and I had requested to get a regular commission as opposed to a temporary commission. But that never came through, so that was actually worked out very well. So we got our papers, jumped in the car, and drove back to Connecticut.
So why did you decide not to do to make the Air Force a career?
I couldn't get a regular commission. Without that, you're some of the first people that are cut when there's a downgrade. I had run into one of my instructors from NAV school. At the time, he was a senior captain. The next time I saw him, he was a staff sergeant trying to hitch a ride on my aircraft. So he went through that. He didn't have a regular commission either.
Mm-hmm.
So nobody wants to put in 10 years and work up in rank and then all of a sudden say, well, we don't need you in that rank anymore, but you can stay if you want to be a sergeant.
Right.
Usually most people don't want to go backwards.
What was your homecoming like?
Great. It was all family, and it was good. It was one of the few times I was able to travel in uniform, and it was one of the few times my parents had ever seen me in uniform. And it was obviously because of the sentiment in the States at the time. But it was terrific.
Huh. What did you do in the days and weeks afterward?
Looked for a job. Not easy to come by. It was 1974. And there was a depression, recession going on. Nobody was hiring anybody, so it took probably 9 months before I got a job. Wow. And it was through a friend of a friend.
Wow.
Networking is good.
Yeah. So when they discharge you, are they just, that's it, or?
I looked at the paperwork. It says I was transferred to a reserve unit. I never contacted them. They never contacted me. So as far as I was concerned, I was done with the Air Force.
Oh, wow. Did you work or go back to school?
Like I said, I searched for a job, finally got one with the Stanley Works out of New Britain. And that was sufficient for me.
All right. So what was the job?
I was a production control individual. I was responsible for purchasing aluminum for their magic door division. And that was it. I did that for 14 years.
Oh. Okay. Was your education supported by the GI Bill?
No, it wasn't. I had graduated college prior to enlisting.
So how old were you when you enlisted?
21.
Did you make any close friendships in the service?
Yes, I did. Unfortunately, I've lost touch with all of them. It worked for a while, but people had different ideas and you drift apart, so.
Mm-hmm. And I guess they're from different parts of the U.S., right?
All over. Hawaii to the west and all the way up and down the East Coast.
Wow.
I had searched a website for military personnel, looking for people I had flown with before, and I didn't find one on that particular website. Maybe they're out on a different one.
Wow. So what did you go on to do as a career after your service?
Like I said, I started out in production control, moved into purchasing, became a purchasing agent for a small company called Locknetics. Did that for about 10 years, and was made a purchasing agent for them, material manager, and did that for another 5 years. And then I left that company.
Okay. How did your military experience influence your thinking about war or the military in general?
I've always had a good impression of the military. I don't think they're too far off base anywhere. So I would say I had a good impression before I went in, and still have a good impression of the military.
Was it difficult because of the, I guess, like during the Vietnam War, a lot of the public backlash, I guess, stays a little.
That hurt a lot. If I had known there was going to be amnesty for all the people who went to Canada, I'd probably be speaking French. But I didn't really look at it that way. It was, I'm going one way or the other. I'm not going to break the law, so I'll either be drafted or I'll enlist. And I enlisted.
Did you join any veteran organizations?
I have not, other than the VA for medical and other problems.
Do you attend reunions?
I'm sorry?
Do you attend like reunions? Or?
No, I haven't seen a reunion notice anywhere. Probably nobody knows where I am.
So how did your service and experiences affect your life?
Kind of hard to pin that down because there's nothing in that I'm doing in civilian life that I did in the military. When I got out of the military, jobs for navigators, even in commercial airlines, were disappearing, being replaced by inertial nav systems, which were more accurate than I could be.
Is there anything you'd like to add?
Yeah, I think you covered it pretty well.
Okay.
It was disappointing after I got home and separated. When I did get home, I ended up throwing away all my uniforms and everything that even looked military because of the backlash. Looking back, I kind of regret that. I'd like to have some of that back. That's it. Time is gone.
Right. So how long were you in service at in Southeast Asia?
I was there twice. The first one was a year flying airborne command and control. I didn't separate. I came back to Langley. I was there for 3 months, and then sent back on temporary duty, which was longer than I thought was temporary. And that was for flying, they call them Kong hoppers out of Saigon. And you would take off in the morning and fly, you know, 6 to 10 sorties back into Saigon. And it was just hauling materials and ammunition, whatever they needed moved, and you would pick up and take. The worst thing about the job?
Yes.
it was some of the cargo I had to carry. This was flying the Kong hoppers. The worst that I had to carry was pallets of body bags.
Oh, wow.
And we would pick them up, and there would be 5 to 6 pallets in there, like 8-foot square, and they'd stack them 3-4 feet high, and you never know who was in them.
Oh, so it's American or?
I would guess they were American, but you don't know.
Right.
There was a lot of them, but I think they would make sure that the U.S. personnel went back to Saigon. So it was probably a combination of U.S. personnel and South Vietnamese personnel. That was absolutely the worst for me.
What was the other cargo that you?
It was just anything. We could drop off, you know, rockets to play coup, or, you know, take something into Da Nang up to Hue, and it was just general cargo. And I didn't know what was in it. As long as the loadmaster said it correctly, I'm in good shape. So
what were the, did you fly different aircraft? Yeah.
No, my whole time was spent in C-130s, four engine turboprop. It's small, but it's a major part of the Air Force inventory.
Right.
So they've been in use since 1947, and they're still making them.
So were you only trained for that, or do you know how to?
Yes, that was the only one I was trained for. If I had transferred to a different aircraft, I'd be required to learn their systems.
Oh, were you happy with that one?
Oh yeah, it was terrific. We did a lot of strange things. Besides having the capability to parachute equipment down to the ground as well as personnel, it has a short takeoff and landing capability, which means it's very rapid acceleration and very rapid deceleration. G JATO bottles they would hang on the sides of the aircraft. It's a jet-assisted takeoff. And when those kicked in, you're pushed back in your seat and away you go in a very short amount of time. Mm-hmm. Landed on dirt, dropped, they call it LAPES, low-altitude parachute extraction. We practiced with that. It never really came into use, but it was interesting learning that.
Yeah.
Oh. So yeah, I was happy with it.
Oh, okay. Did you always like land in another base or?
Not necessarily. In Pope, where we were dropping troops, we would fly a 1 hour, 500 foot contour out to the drop zone, drop the personnel, and then we'd fly back and load it up again and try again.
Oh. So did they ever? Did you always fly when you knew it was like a safe time, or was it just
whenever they wanted to fly? You better be ready to go. So I always had an emergency kit, a couple of pairs of underwear, jeans, a shirt, and I only had to use it once. We got a call in the middle of the night. You know, your plane is leaving in 2 hours. Come down and we'll brief you on where you're going. So you take your bag and off you go. Well, that ended up going into Amman, Jordan.
Oh, wow.
So we have flown all over the world. And the only continent I didn't land on is Australia.
Wow. So there was... So why did you go to all these... Not just in the...
Most of the times that I went to Europe, it was a standard 3 month rotation. You'd be in Europe for 3 months and home for 3 months, Europe for 3 months and home. And we'd be usually stationed at Frankfurt in Germany, and a couple of times in Mildenhall, England. But you would fly out of wherever your home base was, and usually you never fly empty. You pick something somewhere, pick up something else, and maybe deliver that somewhere else, and then fly back to your home base.
After being discharged, did you ever fly again?
No. Mm. No, I wasn't rated to mess with the controls, but I had some good pilots that flying for Moonbeam, the airborne command and control. I would fly with the pilot, and then the flight engineer and the co-pilot would fly. We'd shift every 3 hours because we were in the air for 12.
Oh, wow.
So,
how did you? I mean, I guess you were flying a plane, but how did you stay busy during 12 hours?
That's why we broke it up. You got a chance to take a quick cat nap. Mm-hmm. And you still had somebody that knew what was going on sitting in the pilot seat. And it worked. It was a system that they had put in place before I got there, and they kept it going through my whole time there. Worked out very well.
I guess, what was the best part about being in the Air Force?
It allowed me to see a lot of stuff I never would have seen before. All the places we landed, and like I said, it was just about anywhere you wanted to go. Southeast Asia, all the way to the Middle East. So everything in between. It was an educational experience, if nothing else.
Well, I'd like to thank you for your service and also taking the time to be interviewed today.
Thank you very much. Glad I could do it for you.
Yeah, thank you.